then Gordon Thompson, and then Ed Lyman. Mr. Alvarez?
Good morning. I'll be brief since several issues have already been covered in the panel. I feel like we should be running over the squirrel over and over. What I will discuss and ask is, when looking at your study, I came to the conclusion that you did not look at multiple risk factors in terms of concurrence impacts on a reactor. And it's been well known, I mean, if you sort of just take a little bit of a dive into NRC-sponsored research, 85, 90, specifically at this reactor, in terms of beyond design basis events, that these studies actually predicted quite accurately what happened at Fukushima, especially the discharge and accumulation of large amounts of explosive hydrogen in the fuel base that caused really severe destruction of the entire spent fuel infrastructures, including the collapse of the cranes into one of the pools. And so I'm curious why you didn't look at these multiple risk factors, because to me it looks like, you know, having worked on the Hill and having to explain this to members of Congress, it looks like you've done this sort of study in a vacuum that excludes all the other variables that would impact the spent fuel pool, especially you know, when you take a look at the aftermath. Let's assume we haven't had a large release that's occurred, you know, that didn't occur at Fukushima Pool 4. It is turning into quite a daunting task to come to terms with even physically removing this material right now. And so why didn't you look at that?
We did look at, you know, during the outage when the reactor and the spent fuel pool are connected, we do look at the decay heat from the reactor. So that, you know, as long as they were thermohydraulically connected, but the study was focused on the consequence of the spent fuel pool itself. So we just looked at, you know, we wanted to know what's the difference between high density and low density. We do have some sensitivity.
Doesn't this sort of violates the basic principles of systems engineering?
Again, the study was a certain scope, and we recognized the limitation of the scope of the spent fuel pool study done in research. So in our regulatory analysis, we made conservative assumptions to bound what that effect would be. And for example, we recognized that there could be a reactor accident occurring at the same time as a spent fuel pool accident. So what we and that would take operator attention away from any mitigating strategies possible in the spent fuel pool. So what we assumed conservatively to make the low density loading more safety beneficial than the high density loading, we assumed that the mitigation strategies will be 100% effective for the low density loading. And then we assumed that the high density loading, all the mitigation strategies would not be effective. So we feel that we, again, did a conservative assumption to bound this influence of the state of the reactor and the attention drawn away from the spent fuel pool.
As you know, the spent fuel pool is really a system. It involves refueling cavities, membranes, transfer equipment, etc. Did you consider the possibility of a full core offload in a refueling cavity?
We did not look at full core offload because, as we stated in the, one of the assumptions is that this is not typical.
I understand that, but, you know, having worked in this industry for 40 years, one thing about the nuclear enterprise is that it's a surprise when there are no surprises.
Right. So because it was, you know, the study was supposed to be a best estimate. And so we were not looking at all the conditions, all the bounding conditions. We were looking at, you know, a best estimate of how the accident progresses.
But you do have a relatively high frequency of usage of these systems, and where I'm not saying that it's always a full core offload, there's certainly at least one third of the core going into these refueling cavities at any given time. And you did not look at the impact of that of an earthquake impacting, let's say, one third of the core during a refueling?
As the fuel is being removed to the spent fuel pool?
Yeah, in the refueling cavity.
Yeah. All right, this is Steve Jones.
Yes.
The study implicitly assumed that there was fuel movement into the spent fuel pool. There's no fuel that remains in the cavity per se. It's either in the reactor, there's one assembly in transit, and then it's placed in the storage location in the spent fuel pool during a typical refueling.
Okay. Well, you answered my question. The other issue I'm curious about is aging deterioration of the pools. When I read your study, you have two citations. One is an NEI study about an aircraft impact into a pool, and the other is a 1989 study. And I'm aware of at least of a 2001 study that the NRC sponsored by Oak Ridge, which I'll just quote. It says, as nuclear plants age, degradations of spent fuel pools, reactor refueling cavities are incurring at an increasing rate, primarily due to environmental-related factors. During the last decade, a number of nuclear power plants have experienced water leakage from spent fuel pools and reactor fueling cavities. The authors of the study also indicate that accurate assessment of aging of spent fuel pools is uncertain because, quote, it's often hard to assess what's going on underground in essence. Instead, I found it curious that you point to a study that was 24 years ago where none of these effects were being observed, at least in looking at your references. And how do you come to terms with that? How do you reconcile that?
Yeah.
We did not explicitly account for degradation effects of the material. The NRC does keep informed in their studies on the degradations of materials in the pools. It's just recently there was a report published, but we did sensitivity analysis. We considered the vary properties of the concrete. We also varied the properties of the limiting strains in the liner. We assumed conservative limiting strains in the liner. We noticed that for the most part, weldments in the liner tend to be away from the discontinuities in the pool, where you have cross sections between walls, so there are areas of low strains. Also, when we looked into detail at the liner, it turns out that it's a very complex component. Under the liner, there are drainage channels, and these drainage channels try to collect water that might leak through the liner on a regular basis to limit the amount of water that leaks through the concrete. And that water is collected by these drainage channels, and it's normally a very small amount of water. It's usually less than water lost by evaporation in a day. So it is, even though it was not explicitly accounted for, we did sensitivity analysis.
Well, do you think that the deterioration that goes undetected can occur, bring about a nonlinear event?
This is Steve Jones. I just wanted to clarify on the operating experience we've had so far has been very minor leakage in a variety of locations in a select number of nuclear power plants, and it's been on the order of tens to hundreds of gallons per day, nothing that would even approach threatening the ability to maintain inventory in the pool. The normal status is there is no leakage, and these channels monitor that on a regular basis.
To get to the just add a little bit to the point that Dave Lockbaum raised, this same study, this 2001 study, also noted that borinated water enhances the degradation of concrete. So there's quite a bit of mitigation going on because of deterioration of neutron absorbing panels by compensating by adding more boron to the water, in some cases, cyanofree being one. I'm not familiar with all the reactors out there, but these are also factors that I just want to mention.
Can I just add to that? I mean, I think that the answer that Jose provided, that we did vary the properties, the structural properties of both the liner and the concrete account for the reductions, as I think you're trying to lead us to, in any of the material properties due to aging.
I have one more question, I'll be gone. Why didn't you compare the hazards of high-density storage with dry cask storage? I mean, the relative hazards, because at least in terms of your emergency preparedness and planning, I'm referring to New Reg 1889, where, you know, you're using your, it's the RASCA model. You use the RASCA model, and this is what it was done for, thank goodness, for desktop purposes, not for real-world purposes, but the underlying assumptions in that particular report seem to come from the 87 Brookhaven study in terms of release fractions and things like that. But it does note that your releases, if someone were to put a shape charge on a dry cask, it would release about 2,500 times less radioactivity than a pool fire. That is a tremendous difference in consequences. And so why didn't you look at that? I mean, the other issue is just take a look at the Fukushima site. You had 408 assemblies and 9 dry casks, which were unscathed.
The way we handled this is, of course, the fuel needs to be aged to a certain point and decay heat load dropped, as you know, before it goes into a cask. And what we did is we assumed that there was no risk posed by the casks, and we compared it to the risks posed by a fully loaded pool. And again, the delta between that, which would then equate to the safety increase, was not enough in our regulatory process to warrant regulatory action.
This includes your increased source terms due to high burn up and
yes,
the like.
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much.
This is Steve Jones. I did just want to point out that the spent fuel pool study does include in Chapter 10 a comparison of relative consequences between pools and dry casks. It may help answer your question.
Thank you.